Good morning.
Good morning.
For our call to worship this morning, I'd like to read from Psalms 92, the first three verses and the first part of verse 4. It says, "It is good to give thanks to the Lord and to sing praises to thy name, O Most High, to declare thy loving kindness in the morning and thy faithfulness at night, with the ten-string lute and with the harp, with resounding music upon the lyre. For thou, O Lord, hast made me glad by what thou hast done." We would like to welcome you to the Alburnett Christian Church this morning. Some announcements that we'd like to highlight. On Wednesday, we'll have an elders meeting here at the church at 6:30. I got to bed really late. And then on Thursday, we'll have Bible study here at the church at 7. On the 27th, we'll have annual meeting here at the church with carry and dinner. The committee is going to take care of the meat. We're just asking people to bring side dishes and dessert dishes. Lots of dessert dishes, sorry. And we'll have a really, really short congregational meeting immediately following the morning worship service this morning to vote on replacing the copier. It's really old. They've told me they can't get parts for it anymore. We kind of had a little bit of a scare with it last week where I wasn't sure if I was going to be able to print with it. I have a bid from Access Business Systems, and they've been the ones who've been taking care of us for a long, long, long time. And we'll just have a really, really quick, short vote immediately following the morning worship service on that. Are there any other announcements? Yes.
We are tentatively planning a Secret Sister reveal party on Monday, July 5th. Though we'd like to find out if there's enough people interested to continue doing it. Hopefully there is. If you're interested, contact either Sherry or I. But that's the plans at this point. We'll have more details later.
Okay, so none of that will pick up on the recording, so I'll just really quickly go over that. So they're tentatively, CWF ladies are tentatively planning a Secret Sister reveal party on July the 5th, which is a Monday. Please see Sherry or Pam if you're interested or can help in any way with that. Does that pretty much cover that? Any others?
Yes. Any bills need to be to me?
Since we're very quickly approaching the end of the fiscal year for the church, any bills need to be turned into Mary Sue, like right away. Any others? Do we have any additions or updates on the prayer list? Yes, a couple hands. We'll start with Rose. All right. So Chuck is home from the hospital. He was diagnosed with pneumonia. We just ask for your continued support and prayers in his regard, Katie. All right. So Katie's mom and dad are coming, and Katie's mom has surgery on Tuesday. So just ask that you kind of continue and keep her in your prayers. Any others? Yes, Jenny. So prayers for Dave for a spot on his back that he'll have recovery and healing on that. Melanie and Becca. Melanie took Becca down to my father-in-law's, and then they're going over to camp. So Josh and I were kind of batching it today. If there aren't any others, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our great and our gracious Heavenly Father, we just come before your throne, and as we do so, we thank you for this day that you've given to us, the sunshine, and Lord, just the beautiful summer weather. And as we come before your throne, we just lift up to you those that are on our prayer list. Heavenly Father, those who need your very real and very special touch. We're grateful that Chuck was able to come home from the hospital as he's recovering from pneumonia, and just ask that you just continue to be with him and help him to mend and to heal. We ask, Lord, that you be with Katie's mom as she prepares to go in for surgery on Tuesday, that there be no problems or difficulties of any kind, that you just watch over her and keep her safe, and that Heavenly Father, you just be with the SoCup family as they prepare to begin this process to get some healing and relief to Katie's mom. We ask, Lord, also that you be with Dave and just the spot on his back, that, Lord, it would heal properly, that there be no issues with cancer or anything there. And, Lord, we just pray that you just continue to be with him. And, Lord, with each and every one that's on our prayer list, we have so many that need your very real and very special touch. and ask that you just move in a mighty way and bring victory to your people. All these things we ask and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you guys were paying any attention, last week we kind of had a complete utter failure of recording. We tried to live stream. It went out somewhere. We couldn't find it. It like just disappeared. There was a small technical difficulty and the service didn't get recorded. So we're trying to rectify that this week, and hopefully everything will go really, really well. So our first hymn this morning is hymn number 68. Let's all stand and we'll sing the first, second, and the fourth verse.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown.
Hymn number 511, and we'll sing all three verses of Victory in Jesus. 511.
Precious blood atoning.
Over to hymn number 163. We'll sing the first, the second, and the fourth verse.
The title of our communion meditation this morning is Go and Learn What This Means. From Matthew 9, verses 10 through 13, it says, While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? On hearing this, Jesus said, It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners. Suppose kindergartner teachers only admitted 5-year-old geniuses to his class. Then most of us would never get an education. Suppose the doctor only agreed to see robustly healthy people in her office, then most of us would never get well. Suppose Jesus had come to call only the righteous, then most of us would never be forgiven by him. Suppose God did require sacrifice for salvation, then no offering we could ever make would ever remove our offense. We would never be saved. Suppose the Lord's table was only for those who had neither disappointed nor disobeyed nor doubted their Lord. Then most of us, no, all of us, should pass the bread by unbroken. Watch our cupped reflections pass before us undrunk. Suppose we refused even to gather at the Lord's table because we judged ourselves guilty. Then we would truly be guilty, not just of sin, not just of unrighteousness, but of refusing to come, to follow, to eat as sinners, precisely the ones he came to call, precisely the ones for whom he died, precisely for ones for whom this table is spread. Mercy, what presumption, not only to reject our relationship with God by sinning, but to reject our reconciliation with God by thinking that this meal is not precisely for us sinners. Let us go and learn what this means. This is my body given for you. This is my blood of the covenant poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Now will you join me in singing our communion song, Nearer the Cross, verses 1-2, standing on 4.
Our dear Heavenly Father, as we humbly come before you this Lord's Day at this communion table, we thank you so much that you loved us so much that you sacrificed your one and only Son to suffer and die on that cross for the forgiveness of all of our sins. May we never forget the tremendous pain, suffering, and humiliation he had to suffer to endure the time on the cross so that we may be free of our sins. As we partake today, bless this loaf which represents his broken body and the cup his shed blood. May your Holy Spirit reach down and touch each one who partakes today. Be with us and guide us through this world which is full of evil. Help us to become better connected with communities we live in, and help us to spread the word for those that are willing to listen. Guide us now, protect us in all that we do. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Our invitation hymn will be hymn number 364, if you'd like to keep that in readiness. Hymn number 364. I noticed that during the song service that some of the words were being clipped on the screen, and I'm actually a little surprised that it was working at all. So Friday night, I was over here working and making some of the changes with stuff that we were going to do to the cameras and everything. And I got to bed at a little after 4 o'clock in the morning. And so then yesterday I worked all day, and I got to bed about, well, I left here about 2:30 in the morning. So I vacuumed the sanctuary like four times last week. If there's any messes that you find, it's not Jane's fault. It's all mine. So just apologize for that up front. But hopefully we got most of the things squared away. This morning, if you would, turn with me to the book of Hebrews, chapter 12. I'd like to read verses 1 through 3. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Reading from the New International Version, it says this: "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, that you will not grow weary and lose heart. This is perhaps my favorite passage of scripture in the entire Bible. Everybody has their own favorite scripture. This one, because when I was a much younger, thinner young man, I ran track. And so this passage of scripture really speaks to me. This is not the only passage of scripture that uses sports type illustration to try and bring across this point. The Apostle Paul will also talk about the boxer and the athlete, and he will say, I buffet my body and I make it my slave so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified. In Hebrews chapter 12, Hebrews, the book of Hebrews, is unsigned. It's one of the few books of the Bible that we're not actually completely for certain who wrote the book. Some will say that it was the Apostle Paul. Some will say that it was Apollos. Some will say even that Luke wrote it. And part of the reason that some people say Paul didn't write it is because that normally he signs his books. You know, the other epistles, Paul will say something like, Paul, an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, blah, blah, blah. In the book of Hebrews, it's not signed. I am of the personal opinion, I think, and it's not a matter of faith by any means, but I'm kind of the opinion that Paul wrote it. And I know that my cousin Jeff, who went to Crossroads Bible College, kind of thinks that Apollos wrote it. The literary style is a little bit different than what Paul normally does. But then again, the audience to whom the author is speaking in Hebrews is different than Paul's normal audience. Paul normally went and preached to the Gentile people. That's where God sent him. But Paul's heart was for his own people. His heart was for the Jewish people. And Paul actually writes in Scripture that I would condemn my very soul to hell if it meant that my brethren, my Jewish fellow people would accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Now, a lot of people, they say, understood that, and it gives you an idea of how much he wanted for his people, the Jewish people, to accept the Messiah. And the book of Hebrews is different because it is addressed to the Jewish people, to the Hebrew people. It is the only book in the New Testament that is written in Hebrew. The rest of the books are written in either Aramaic or in Greek. And whoever the author of Hebrews is, he has a very, very, very good grasp of the Jewish culture, their backgrounds, their customs, the Torah, the Jewish law, a tremendous understanding of all of those things. And I think, I'm of the opinion, that the book of Hebrews is written a little bit different. Paul didn't sign it because if he did, there's a lot of people that would immediately quit reading. And he didn't want that. And so I think it's unsigned for that reason. The book is written a little bit differently because you're talking to a different group of people. When I talk to Bethany about computer stuff, I talk to her very differently than I talk to Alex when I'm talking about computer stuff. And a shout out to him because he came over Monday and helped me with my Facebook stuff and got the ATEM Mini so that it would record. But, you know, we talk differently to different people based off of their understanding and their grasp of the topic that we're dealing with. I think that applies here in this case as well. Whoever the author here is in Hebrews, he uses this illustration of a runner and compares it to our faith. And so this morning, there are three things that I would like to bring out. The first is this. The author says that we need to throw off everything that hinders. In Hebrews 12:1, it says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race that is marked out for us." Let me get that from a different translation. Let's go to the New Living Translation. It says there, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily hinders our progress, and let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us." Now, when I was in Bible college, I had a professor that said, whenever you come to a therefore, you need to ask yourself, what is the therefore there for? It says there in that verse, verse 1, it says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses." Well, what is this cloud of witnesses that the author here is talking about? Well, the Bible never originally was broken down into chapters and verses. That was actually something that was done by a circuit riding preacher here in the United States to make it easier for people to look up and find passages of Scripture. Originally, the Scripture was written just as a book. There was no chapter breaks. There was no verse breaks. And I think that sometimes the guy who was breaking our Bible down into chapters and verses, that he must have hit a bump or something as he's riding his horse from one place to the next, and maybe didn't do the greatest job of breaking things up. In the context of this passage of Scripture, we come through from Hebrews chapter 11, the chapter that's referred to as the faith chapter. And it talks about all of these men and women of faith who by their faith conquered people, you know, enemies, were found, you know, did these great acts, all of these different things. And it goes down through this list of, you know, this guy who did this, and this guy who did this, and this guy who did this. And it makes this one statement, which I think is just this tremendous affirmation of these people's faith, because it goes through and it talks about these people who were stoned and sawn in two and suffered and struggled for their faith. And it makes a statement. It says, "Men of whom the world was not worthy." In other words, as the Bible is giving an account of these men and women of faith who suffered and struggled to accomplish these things, the Bible there in Hebrews 11 says the world wasn't even worthy of these people. And it comes down there to the end, and then it says, "Therefore, since we are encompassed by such a great cloud of witnesses." I think that what Hebrews here is telling us is that the author goes through all of these men and women of faith and then says, since all of these people who have endured all of these hardships, come through all of this testing of their faith and have remained faithful, since they are watching us from the grandstands of heaven, let's lay aside everything that encumbers us and the sin that so easily besets us. So what he's saying there is, I think that all of those who have gone on before, those who have been faithful, those who have died in Jesus Christ, that they are watching us and they are cheering us on as we are running our race for Jesus Christ. Back a million years ago when I was in track, my dad came to every track meet. Much like you guys, you know, moms and dads and grandpas and grandmas go to every baseball game, softball game, football game, basketball game, all of the stuff that your kids and grandkids are a part of. My dad did that too. And I didn't really appreciate how what it was like to sit in the stands on those cold, cold, cold early spring evenings until I had some of my own kids that were in track. And I'm telling you, it's cold. you know, but my dad was always there to, you know, to be there to encourage me, to yell, you know, to get going. And the same kind of picture is presented for us here in Hebrews chapter 12 of those who have gone on before, who are in the grandstands of heaven, cheering us on as we run our race for Jesus Christ. He then says to throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. You know, when I was in track, we had these shoes, right? These track shoes that we ran in. And they just weighed just a few ounces. You know, we had a tank top and shorts. You know, not the kind of shorts that, you know, guys find to be in style today. You know, the ones that go down to your knee or a little below. These were, you know, the short kinds. Not like girls' short shorts, but short for a guy, right? And they even had holes in them. And I think it was to make them lighter, right? Because you wanted to be as light and fast as possible. Can you imagine if you were going to run a race? You know, I mean, it was cold at some of those track meets. So can you imagine putting on your boots, you know, your steel-toed boots and your long johns and your shirts and your Carhartts and then getting out there and lining up to run your race? It would be a horrible situation. I mean, you'd probably die a heat stroke by the time you got done if you managed to finish. And you'd just be so bound up in all of that clothing that it would be very, very difficult for you to run at all. In the Greeks, in their games, they actually participated without any clothes at all. I'd found that to be a little uncomfortable myself, but especially as I've gotten older. But, you know, this Paul uses this thing that is from the running of setting aside everything that was going to slow us down so that we can run the race that Jesus has set out for us. He says to set aside the things that throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. You see, many times in our race with Jesus Christ, we are hanging on to stuff that's slowing us down in our race. Bad habits. Maybe it is associating with people that instead of helping to lift us up and encourage us in our race, are dragging us back and slowing us down. When I was, man, this has been forever ago. When I was, I think I must have been a freshman. One of my friends was, his name was Todd. And I ran in practice with Todd all the time. And so we came to the first track meet. It was what they called a triangle, and so it was only three teams, and the advantage of that was you could load up as many people as you wanted. There wasn't any limits to the number of people that you could put in a race because there's not very many teams, and it was really good to have those at the beginning of the season because it gave you the coach a chance to see what everybody was going to be able to do. And so like the 220 and the 100 yard dash and the 440, man, the coach would load up like eight guys to run this thing. And I'd never really run that much before, a little bit maybe in junior high. And I've been running with Todd, and he wasn't quite as fast as me. And so, you know, after like the fifth heat, the slowest heat, because I'd never had any times run on me before, they put me and Todd, it's just the two of us that are left in this very last heat. And so the gun goes off, and I take off, and I'm running as fast as I can, and I left poor Todd behind. And I think I, like, tied for first or second or third place with the very fastest heat, and Todd is like, man, thanks a lot, Dan, you know. But sometimes we're busy running with people that are slowing us down. They're not pushing us to be the best or the fastest or, you know, that we can be as Christian people. And we need to find for ourselves people that will lift us up and encourage us to be better Christians. You know, there are some leaders who, because they are worried about their own leadership abilities, that they'll make sure that the people that are underneath them are not as good as they are, because they have low self-esteem, and they're worried about that. But a really, really, really good leader will surround himself with the very best people that he can find, because he knows that it will make him a better leader as well. And that's true of us as Christian people. Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't associate with non-Christian people. If we did that, we might as well, you know, put on our monk costumes and you know, separate ourselves from the world. That can't happen and carry out the mission that God's given to us. In order for us to reach out to a lost world, we have to, you know, reach out to non-saved people. But those people that you are closest to, those people that are most important to you, need to be people that are going to encourage you in your race with Jesus Christ. And we need to make sure that we're putting that sin aside that slows us down as well. You know, years ago, and I don't know what people do today, they used to have these weights that you could strap onto your legs and stuff, and you would run and practice with that stuff. And then when the day of the race came, you'd take that off and you could run faster. I know that when Josh was in track, one of the things that they actually had to try and make guys faster is they would make them run with parachutes. You know, not a real big parachute, but a parachute that would billow out and slow them down, so they have to pull against it as they're trying to run to build up their muscles, to build up their strength. Well, you know, many times for us, that sin that we continue to struggle with over and over and over again is like those weights, or like that parachute that's just dragging us back in our race with Jesus Christ, and we got to cut it loose. We have to cut it loose if we're going to win that race and be the Christian that Jesus wants us to be. The second thing is, we need to run with perseverance. We need to run with perseverance. Hebrews 12:1, again, but I'm going to emphasize a different part of that verse, says this: therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. I'm going to read it again, but this time from the New King James Version. So this is a third translation of this passage of Scripture. It says, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. I had three different track coaches in the 4 years that I was in high school. I don't know if that's an indication of my ability as a runner, or our track team that we just, you know, they moved on. I don't know exactly what the deal was there. But my very freshman year, the track coach, he gave us our uniforms, loaded us all up into a bus, took us out to the middle of nowhere out in the country, kicked us off and said, okay, I'll be timing you to see how long it takes you to get back. And he was pretty smart too. He picked a place where there was no way to hitchhike or get a ride from anybody else. And a lot of the practices, you would come down after school as you're getting ready for practice, and the coach would have the list of stuff that you were going to do up on the wall. And the list might have one set of things that the distance runners were going to do and another set of things that the sprinters were going to do. But I remember coming down there and looking at that list and thinking on many occasions, there's no way that I'm going to make it to the end of practice. I'm not going to make it, right? We had this one thing that we did. Well, I had a couple of things that were kind of brutal. So one was called the Indian drill. Any of you guys, do you still do those? Yeah. We called them fartleks, but it was an Indian drill. And so what you did is everybody got in a line and you started jogging. And then the guy in the back of the line would sprint to the front, and then the next guy that was in the back would sprint to the front, and so on and so forth. So you're always jogging, but then you're also running as well. My brother love sports to watch on TV. And he hated to ride the bus. Absolutely hated the bus, but there was only one car. So, and since I had to have it for track, if he wanted to not be on the bus, the only way that that could happen was for him to also go out for track. It was, you know, we go to track, and we would come home, and for like 2 weeks, my dad loved it. He absolutely loved it, because at the supper table, he got a blow-by-blow commentary of how practice went every night for my brother, who hated it, by the way. That only lasted for about 2 weeks before David decided that the bus was better than track was. But in this one particular case, we were doing these Indian drills, and we were going out of town a couple miles to like this mansion that was called Clemens, and coming back. And David talked. It was so funny to hear him describe it. Him and his posse, his crew of guys, we're heading out there, and eventually it breaks into two groups. So they're running along, and David is in the back, and he sprints to the front, and he says, "Boom! I'm back in the back again," and he's like, "Ah!" And so he's tired, and he doesn't want to go. And his friend is right in front of him, and he says, "David, you're supposed to run to the front." And David goes, "I am not running to the front." And so his friend breaks out and sprints to the front, and immediately, boom, he's back in the back again. And then neither of them sprinted to the front anymore. And he says it broke, and pretty soon this long line breaks into two groups. And the first group leaves the second group behind. And he says, "We're running and we're running and we're tired. And finally we can see them." And all of the guys from the first group are lounging around and resting and laying. And they're like, "Yes, finally I get a break." And just as they get up there, it's like, "Okay, guys, let's head on back." And he said, this time it was immediately two groups. It didn't take any time at all. And he says, as we're coming back into town, here come the weight guys. Who have been to Casey's and are chomping down candy bars as they are trying to do their thing, right? But all of the exercises that we did were to make our body stronger, but not just to make our body stronger. They also gave us endurance. They gave us perseverance so that when the going got tough, we continued to keep going. The other one that I really, really hated was kind of like ladders that they do for basketball, where you sprint to the free throw line and back to the wall, and half court line and back to the wall, and so on and so forth. We did that, but we did it on the track. So you sprinted 100 meters and then you jogged 100 meters. You sprinted 200 meters and jogged 200 meters, all the way up to 800 meters and all the way back down. The first couple were not so bad. The last 100 meters was horrible, right? Because you're just absolutely dying. But all of that hard work gave you the endurance and the perseverance so that when you're running that 440 and you hit the wall, when you get to the last set of curves, you don't give up. You just keep plugging. You just keep, you know, pushing. And that's the same kind of thing that we need as Christian people. We need that perseverance, that stick-to-itiveness that says, no matter what, I refuse to give up. I will not surrender. You know, Winston Churchill's most famous speech was actually his shortest. And his speech was, never give up, never give up, never, never, never give up. That was the entire speech, right? But that's the kind of attitude that we need to have as Christian people, that no matter what, I refuse. I will never, ever give up. My brother-in-law, Mike, I've heard Melanie and my father-in-law say several times that, you know, if you ever get into a fight with him, you're just going to have to knock him out and leave. Because when he comes back too, he's going to get right back up and try to fight you again. Because he's got that kind of determination, that stick-to-itiveness that says, never going to give up. When he was a kid, he worked at the nursing home. doing custodial work there, and he got into an arm wrestling match with a guy, and the guy literally broke his arm because Mike wouldn't give up. And I'm not saying that that's a good thing, but I am saying that in our race with Jesus Christ, we need to have that stick-to-itiveness, that determination that says, I will never, ever give up no matter what. And then thirdly, we need to fix our eyes on Jesus. Fix our eyes on Jesus. Hebrews 12:2, reading from the NIV, says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So, in track, the ultimate goal was always the finish line. And if you're running, you know, a 100-meter dash, then you run as hard and fast as you possibly can all the way to the end. But if you're running something like the 2 mile, you can't do that. You'll never make it. And so you sprint for position, and then you run a fast pace, as fast a pace as you can manage, until you get to the end, and then you start sprinting again, and hopefully you're out of energy, completely out of energy by the time you hit the finish line. Right? If they miscalculated, you've seen those guys that fade at the end because they started to push too soon. Right? But everything that you do has as its ultimate goal the finish line. You may set some other temporary goals, as like the person that's ahead of you, or, you know, the person that's ahead of them, to try and pace yourself with that person. You know that they run better times than you, and so you're going to try and hang with them. But ultimately, everything that you try to do has as its ultimate goal the finish line. You know, here in this passage of Scripture, the author here says that we need to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who, for the scorn set before him, endured the cross, scorning its shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. In other words, Paul, or whoever the author of Hebrews here is saying that as we run our race, as we struggle with our Christian faith, we need to keep focused on Jesus. You know, there are so many people that leave church for one reason or another, and most of the time it's because their eyes were focused on someone or something other than Jesus. If you are coming to church because the preacher has a great message, or the song service is so uplifting and spiritual, you're coming for the wrong reasons. We come here to worship Jesus, to give him his due. And everything that we get on top of that is just icing on top of the cake. If you put your faith and your hope and your trust in a person, I don't care which person it is, you're going to be disappointed. Because they're not perfect. The only perfect one is Jesus. And we need to keep our eyes focused on him. And then when things don't, when that person does something that we're, you know, a little disappointed with, it's not the end of the world, because Jesus is the person that we're focused on. Not the preacher, not the song leader. You see what I'm saying here? I watched this one show, and in the show, it showed these guys that were running, and it just bugged me, because this person that was running, whoever was the star of the show or whatever, the main lead character, kept looking over their shoulder to see where the person was that was behind him. And I don't know how it is for Gavin, but when I was in track, that was like no. That's like a no bueno kind of deal, right? Because number one, if you're busy turning around looking behind you, you can break your stride, run out of your lane, and get disqualified. Or if the guy is right behind you, sees you looking at him, he knows that you're worried, it may give him just the encouragement that he needs to pass you right? So you needed to keep your focus on the finish line. As Christian people, we need to keep our focus on Jesus and the finish of our faith, our hope of heaven. The Apostle Paul is able to say, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, therefore there is laid up for me the crown of life which the righteous judge shall give to me on that day. And not to me only, but all those who have loved his appearing. You see, we need to keep our eyes on Jesus. And if we do, then we'll finish our race. The beauty of this race that's different than running at state or any of the other track meets that are out there is that in any other race, there's only one winner, right? Rusty Wallace used to say in the NASCAR circuit, second place is nothing more than the first loser, right? That was his theory on the whole deal. There's only one winner. But in our race with Jesus Christ, everyone who is faithful to the end wins the same thing. We all win eternal life with Jesus in heaven. And so we want to do the very best that we possibly can, but the ultimate goal, the ultimate prize is to cross that finish line with Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. If Jesus isn't your Lord and Savior, then that's where you need to begin. This morning, our invitation hymn is hymn number 364. And let's stand as we sing the first and the final verse of hymn number 364. Father God, as we come before your throne, we are just so grateful and thankful for your love and for your grace and for your mercy and all the ways that you have been so very, very good to us. Heavenly Father, we just pray that you'd help us to be faithful in our race with Jesus Christ and that we would be faithful to the very end, just like the Apostle Paul. We ask now that as we leave this place, that you'd watch over us, direct us, and keep us, and that you'd help us to carry our faith with us to all who will listen. It's in Jesus' precious and holy name that we pray. Amen.